You're watching The Breakfast Club.
Morning, everybody. It's DJ Envy, Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. We got a special guest in the building.
One of my favorite voices in the game.
Dr. Marc Lamont Hill.
What's up,
you a doctor?
Yeah.
That's what they tell me, yeah.
Everybody sounds surprised.
I don't use it. That's why.
Yeah, but I never heard you.
Yeah, I got a PhD.
Doctor. Okay, okay.
Yeah, I don't like to use
you
it.
You got it. You better use it. You work for
it. Yeah, I don't even like to use it like
I like
that.
The other
you went
do
to school
that.
For it.
You went to Temple, right?
I got my PhD from Penn, but I went to Temple, yeah.
I always wonder how you escaped the mean streets of Philly, man. Because, you know, it's so easy to get into the street life in Philly. Like, who implemented education in your life?
You know, it's crazy. I guess my parents did. I was a reader. I went to, and I got on the school bus. I grew up in North Philly, but I took the school bus up to the Northeast, which was like, it wasn't a good neighborhood, but it was just a lot of white people there.
Gotcha.
So like, they had teachers and books and stuff like that. And so I
did that.
Sorry, because in my neighborhood,
like
they didn't have none of that. You know what I
gotcha.
Mean? So we went up there and did that. But, you know, a lot of it was just luck, man. I did stuff, I just didn't get caught. My brother just came home. You know what I mean? So, like,
yeah.
You know, it's just sometimes it's just luck and circumstance.
So you was in the street a little bit. A
little bit, man. But, you know, And then when I went to Morehouse first, and I dropped out and got in more trouble. Took some time off, and was really messing up. And at one point, I was homeless, man. And then
okay,
I started to get it.
Everybody, every rapper, everybody.
They be lying, though. No,
so
no, no.
Was you really homeless?
I lived
staying
in
with a friend.
I lived in the Lenox Mall train station on the floor.
Yikes!
Wow.
That's what I'm saying. Like not
damn.
Like.
How come you couldn't go back home?
I probably could have, but I think part of it was I wanted to have a certain kind of experience, right? I wanted to be able
you
to
wanted
set,
to experience homeless?
Not like on some abstract intellectual stuff. I mean, like, I think in my mind, I felt like I had a different destiny, a different life. Mm-hmm. And I was like, yo, I can't go back home. I can't do this. And I was just convincing myself that wasn't what I was supposed to do.
Too much pride, you think?
A lot of it was pride. Then it got cold. And people think Atlanta don't get cold. It's not cold if you're inside in Atlanta.
Yeah,
but like,
yeah.
if November, December come, I don't care where you at. It's cold if you're sleeping outside. And after a while, man, I just decided to come home. And that's what I did. I came home, came back to Philly, slept into my mom's basement for a minute, worked full time, and then got back to school, and then just been running ever since.
How long was this homelessness?
About 4 months, 4 or 5 months.
4 months. And then what did you do in the meantime? Did you work during this process?
I was, so I didn't want to sell like dope or weed, nothing like that. I did that in high school a little bit, but like I wanted to, I was selling incense, man. I was selling incense, bootleg tapes back in, you know, back in the day, like the VHS tapes, bootleg CDs, all that stuff, Atlantic Mall train station, incense, oils. I was still doing some stuff. You remember Dr. York?
Hell yeah.
Yeah, so I was.
Malachi York.
That's part of how I ended up homeless. That's a whole other story. But
you was under him?
Yeah, it was HTM, tattoo, man.
Oh,
yeah, so I lived there. I was Ansar. I did all that, man. So I ended up stuck out there on the street hustling for a little bit, and then I came home.
You didn't go to a shelter or anything during that time?
Nah. You know, there was times where I had, like, because I used to sleep in the basement of one of his stores, people's stores and stuff like that. And then I was like, then I had a car, and the car got repo. I was sleeping in the back of the car for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
Then the train station was, like, the last stop. And once the train station didn't last as long as the back of the car in the bookstore, because I was like, it's cold, and I don't like mm-hmm. So I was out.
But then you went back to Morehouse after everything and started teaching.
Yeah, that was the crazy part, man. I went to Temple, then I went to Penn. And then about 2 years ago, Morehouse called me and said, you want to come back? And I was like, yo, it's been 18 years since I dropped out. It'd be kind of ill to go back and be the person who I probably needed when I was there. Somebody who could have told me to stay, who could have convinced me to stay, who could have convinced me to be a different kind of person.
And you taught African American studies?
Yeah, I teach African American
studies. Everybody at HBCU takes that course because they think it's easy. It's not easy.
Not
at
easy.
All.
Oh, it's the hardest, man.
It's
I make
one
it
of
extra
the hardest
difficult.
Courses ever.
Yeah, I make it extra difficult too because people think my class is going to be the easy class because I'm on TV. So they think I'm going to come in there and be like entertaining them and stuff. Like, no, we read. So I add like 10 books to the syllabus.
Yep.
First. Some of them I take off after a couple weeks, but I want them to look at it and decide if they really want to be there. And if they don't, they roll out. Because I might have 50 people the first day. Second day, I might have like 15, 20.
I got a C in that class.
See?
It was so much. I didn't know. I thought it was going to be an easy class. HBCU, African American studies. Oh, this is easy. I'm
African American. A lot of stuff you didn't learn in high school.
I'm black. Right. Nope.
So you got to fill in some of these holes, though. Because I like to hear these stories because it gives kids motivation.
Yeah.
So you're homeless. You went back home. Slept in the basement.
Yeah.
Then how'd you get into school?
So I worked, man. I worked telemarketing for a long time.
I did telemarketing.
I told accident.
So did Envy.
I sold accidental death and dismemberment insurance.
How did that go?
I was pretty good at it because I ain't had no scruples. So I would sign people up that didn't really want it. You know what I mean? It was telemarketing.
Even though they said no, you would.
Yeah, be like, all right, they probably sound like they probably wanted it anyway. So I write their name down, whatever. And in Philly, a lot of people did. Questlove did that. We worked the same spot. Like everybody went through that at the same
you
insurance.
Remember your spiel?
Oh, not anymore, man. Let me see. Marc Hill from JCPenney. Life, I'm calling you for a special offer. Oh my God, for $7.99, I can't remember that. It's been so long, man. It's been like 15 years, man. But nah, it was, I went hard on that. And then my parents didn't really support the tuition the second time around. Mm-hmm. I kind of dropped out. And So I was working full time. I was working 50 hours a week. And then I was taking classes and I was trying to catch up because I've had this sense that I was behind. So I would take, the last year, I took like 24 credit hours, 27 credit hours. Because back then, we ain't doing it on computers. You signed up with the card. So I would like sign up and then get another card and sign up for 13 more credits. And I was taking some online. I was doing all this stuff. And I was just trying to rush. And ever since then, I keep feeling like I'm rushing. I always feel like I'm behind. That's why I take so many jobs, why I do so much stuff. Because I feel like I'm in a hurry. And it was actually the last class that I took at Temple called The Black Woman. That really changed the game for me. And I took it because, one, I needed one more class, and two, I thought there'd be black women in there, right? Yeah. And it was like me and just a room full of black women. But I didn't just have that. I learned about black feminism, and I learned about how to read and write as a job. My professor, Renoir McDonough, was there, and she was a great professor. And I was like, yo, I could do this for a living. Like, this is ill. Like, I never even thought about this at this level. And then I was like, I want to go to grad school. And then I got my way into grad school and been running ever since.
Wow, what do you think for people who say that college isn't really necessary?
It is and it's not. I just feel like we do a lot of stuff that's not necessary. You know what I mean? If you're going to waste your time for 4 years, waste it in college. If you don't know exactly what you want to do, learn something. I think there are other ways to develop skills. Mm-hmm. And I know geniuses who never went. One of the greatest intellectuals of our generation, of the 20th century, John Henry Clark, got his degrees later, but his genius came from self-study. Arturo Schoenberg, same thing.
Malcolm X.
I mean, we're going down the list. We have a bunch of people that didn't do it that way. And in the new economy, there's lots of ways to learn and study without school. You can get direct training and other things. But I do think there's something about being on a college campus, learning from other people. True. Much of what I learned in college wasn't what I learned in the classroom. It was what I learned on campus. It's what I learned in the AUC when I was at Morehouse. It's what I learned through the streets of Atlanta.
They got to change the curriculum, though. Yes. Some of those classes you never use in your life.
That's
never.
True.
I did take this South Indian music class. It was called Sokatu. And we just had to clap to a beat, and then that was the whole class. But that was just to get an A.
What grade you get?
I got an A.
Okay, did everybody get an A?
No, one of my friends actually got a B. I don't know how that happened. No, she was Dominican.
I thought she didn't clap on beat. So I was trying to figure out.
She had a bad attitude. That's why her and the professor didn't really get along. He's an older Indian guy, and she just was kind of nasty to him, and he would say her name wrong, and she would lose it. And so she got a B. We all took that class to get an A, but it really served no purpose.
I think everything you learn in life, you learn in kindergarten.
That's interesting.
Your ABCs, your numbers, the golden rule, doing to others as you would have them do unto you. I think everything you need to know in life, you learn right there in kindergarten.
A little older, because you need your multiplication.
I was about to say, until you got to like pay your bills, do your taxes.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. But I feel what you say, basic principles of life.
The basic principles of life,
I agree.
Now, Mark, I've been watching VH1 Live, and all respect to you, I feel like the show is beneath you.
You know, I knew he was going to say that. I knew he was going to say that. Here's what I say. I disagree, first. The show is developing, and you know how it is with TV. First thing you gotta do is prove that you can hold a time slot. First thing you gotta do is prove that you can host a live show, and then you grow with it. If you watch each week, the guests have changed, right? The first week we had
Stevie J and Shawn O'Neal. Yeah.
Both reality stars, right? And all we talked about was reality stuff. Gotcha. Second week, I had Natori Naughton on with somebody else, with Jackie Christie, and we talked about more stuff. Last night, or Sunday night, we had, who do we have? We had, Dasha Polanco from Orange is the New Black.
Right.
And we had Brandy Maxiel. But we talked about We talked about Bow Wow. We talked about the voting thing. We talked about sexism and patriarchy. We talked with the Melania Trump stuff. I'm expanding the conversation each week.
Gotcha.
But it's a fight. I ain't gonna lie to you. It's a fight every week to grow the show into what I want it to be. If you notice the ads on the show, it was like politics, news, this, and this. But we're trying to feed them slowly.
Yeah, yeah.
And the show in the next couple of weeks will go from one night a week to two nights a week. Eventually, if it grows into a five-night-a-week show, every night won't be reality. Every night won't be those topics. So that's the idea.
I'm like, why would you use Marc Lamont Hill to do pop culture?
Right. Now, I do love doing pop culture.
I mean, you had Huffington Post Live. You did a lot of pop culture on there.
Right.
And mixed it in. And I think pop culture does have a lot to do right now with politics also and everything that's going on in the world.
Yeah. No, and I think that's the key. And for me, I'm trying to find a bridge between audiences. Part of my job as an educator, as an intellectual, is to reach into different audiences.
Gotcha.
And so I did a BET special that same day. Every week that I've done VH1 Live, I've done a BET news special. And some of the people who say, like, we need you to be doing serious stuff, they're not watching
the BET news special. Yeah.
Right? So I was running into a burning building in Ferguson, literally. You know what I mean? And we nobody watched it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then when I do VH1 Live, I got a million people watching. And what I want to do is take those million people and get them to care about the stuff that I'm doing over at BET.
Gotcha.
And the stuff that I still do at CNN. I'm still on CNN. I'm still on BET. But this is a space for me to do something different. And also, I like it. I actually watch Basketball Wives and Love and Hip Hop. Right. I like talking about it. It's not like I had to like put on to do this. Like I actually do.
You watch
it, anyway.
It like at home by yourself, or are you?
I mean, maybe with company, but yeah.
Because usually most guys watch those shows because a girl is over watching it. I don't know a lot of guys
this is what I know,
on their own watching basketball.
Dudes pretend to do stuff because girls is watching. It's like when dude asks for your picture, yo, this is for my girl.
Yeah.
Yeah, they just want a picture.
Stop it.
Yeah, just when you want a picture. Same. Can we curse him?
A little bit.
I won't, but same stuff then. I'm sorry. Same stuff. It's like, you know, a lot of times we act like we do it for somebody else. We just watch it. I like basketball. I think it's interesting. It gives dudes the opportunity to have a soap opera.
That's true.
Without acknowledging that it's a soap opera.
Because I watched The Bachelor, and every time I look up, I'm like, damn, I really like The Bachelor.
Oh, you watched The Bachelor?
What's about
that? I don't know about
that. That's the line, dog. At least I got hip hop in mind, man. The Bachelor, I don't know.
I like girlfriends, and I like girls. And when you tweet about those shows, dudes be like, yo, you watching girls or girlfriends? I'm like, it's a show full of women.
Women, right?
Like, what are you talking about?
Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
But in a way, I feel like it does give it some legitimacy now having Marc Lamont Hill hosting the VH1 Live. It makes you feel like, okay, this is somewhat more of an intellectual vibe to it.
Yeah, we're going to take it in a direction. Yeah, and we do other stuff. I was at the Democratic and Republican conventions doing stand-up. Me and Roxy were doing stand-ups at the convention, talking to candidates, talking to politicians. VH1, I think, is moving in a direction to bridge those audiences.
It's a smart move for VH1.
Now, you covered the DNC. What did you think about it? Because I'm very scared of Donald Trump.
I was at both, and the DNC disappointed me.
Why?
Because it looked like a Republican convention.
Basically,
really? The country's just getting dragged so far to the right that the Republicans are just off the map, and so Democrats are moving to the center. And so it seemed more progressive. I mean, all they talk about, how great America is, how exceptional America. Every speech we liked, even the good ones, was still America's the greatest. No place like America. America's the best. They tried to take the patriotism language that the Republicans usually use at their conferences and use it for their own. They talked about war. They talked about the economy in a way that sounded like Republicans from 20 years ago. Part of why it's so easy for Melania to jack Michelle Obama's speech is because they all saying the same stuff.
Yeah, they all saying
the same stuff. So I'm not scared of Trump. I'm scared of us as a country moving in the wrong direction.
They had places for like the mothers of the movement and stuff like that though. Like they talked about issues that are directly affecting us as a community. Yeah, you didn't see that at all in the RNC.
Oh, RNC, I don't expect that. That's like the Klan convention. I didn't enjoy that at all. But at least they were upfront about what they were about. I have very little trust in what the Democratic Party is doing, and I worry that we're investing so much faith in them out of fear. Mm-hmm. I mean, Republicans always talking about terrorism. But Democrats are playing on a certain kind of terrorism, too. They're essentially saying, if you don't vote for us, you're going to have Donald Trump and your life is going to be ruined.
Right.
And I'm saying that if you frame that as the choice, then you never get to demand what you actually deserve and what you actually want.
You're just picking the lesser of two evils.
Exactly. Let's not choose evil.
Do you like Hillary from what you've seen?
I wouldn't vote for her. I'm voting for the Green Party.
Mm-hmm. See, I was having a discussion with my homegirl about the Green Party. It's Jill Stein. I forget the other libertarian.
Gary Johnson. Yeah.
It's like, they're not going to win.
They're so far from
you. Vote for them, they will.
You think?
If everybody votes for them, they win. I think the problem is we've assumed. All right, let me not give you that because we cool. I ain't going to give you that speech. they're not going to win. I'll concede the point. Right. In the abstract, they could win, but they're not going to win this election. But if the differences between the two candidates aren't vast enough, then I would rather introduce a third candidate. Mm-hmm. To build a movement, because every 4 years we say the third party can't win, so we never invest in the third party. We never grow the third party. If they get 5% of the vote, they can be on the debates. Mm-hmm. And if they're in the debates, now we can change the conversation. We can drag the other people back left. Part of why Hillary's talking all this progressive stuff is because
of Bernie.
Yeah. But what happens when Bernie leaves the stage? A third party is like a constant Bernie, but not just on the issue of economic justice, also on the issue of racial justice, mass incarceration.
But with the third party, like you said, most people that are voting for that third party are what? Democrats. That's taking the vote from Hillary, which is making the Republicans more powerful.
Right, but again, so that plays into the idea that anybody but Trump. And what I'm saying is that I would rather have Trump be president for 4 years and build a real left-wing movement that can get us what we deserve as a people than to let Hillary be president and we stay locked in the same space.
I would rather not have Donald Trump be president.
I don't know
about
Trump, man.
I just feel like a lot of things that he says and does, and he doesn't know what he's doing. I feel like internationally, that could be really dangerous for us if Donald Trump was to be president.
I agree. I don't want Donald Trump to be president.
I would rather not have him there at all.
Let me be clear. I would rather Donald Trump not be president. But what I'm saying is that in the big picture, this is what happens every 4 years. We were like, we can't have Romney be president. I know Obama's not perfect, but we don't want Romney. I know Kerry's not perfect, but we don't want Bush. And so what we end up doing is keep getting these imperfect Democrats who don't take us anywhere. Mm. I'm saying let's move in a direction so we can get the actual agenda we want. And you can't do that. We can afford to lose an election. We can't afford to lose our values. That's all I'm saying.
I don't think 4 years of Trump, we could end up being in a situation like the Brexit or even what's going on in Turkey, like the people totally revolting against their government.
I think that's what we need. I think we need a revolution.
True.
You don't get a revolution if people are comfortable.
I'm with you.
Yeah. In 2004, we were all marching against the war. Now Obama becomes president. We don't do nothing. We don't say nothing about the war.
So you didn't like Barack Obama. You weren't for Barack Obama, what he did for the 8 years.
Did I not like him? I did not think that his presidency was exactly what I predicted it would be. In 2007, I wrote a piece called Not My Brand of Hope. Mm-hmm. And I concede again, he's a better choice than McCain. But I laid out all the things he would not do. And I laid out all the reasons why he would not do it. And I turned out to be fairly correct. I wanted to support a Green Party candidate then, Cynthia McKinney. I want a radical choice because we need a radical change in this country. We can't break down the prison until we have a radical disruption of a status quo. We're in this model. We keep saying the system is broken, and it's not. The system works exactly the way it's supposed to. Mm. So instead of saying the system is broken, let's fix it, we should be saying the system is working and let's break it. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And to break the system, you got to get out of the status quo. Barack Obama, Hillary Clinton, whoever, status quo. Bernie Sanders, still status quo. On the right, very much status quo. Mm-hmm. So I want to get outside the context and imagination of the status quo. I want us to have a deeper freedom dream than that.
You think they're killing us with the illusion that it isn't status quo because Barack's black, because Hillary's a woman?
That's exactly right. And so you get this, you get seduced by symbolism. Mm-hmm. I love seeing Michelle Obama up there. I love seeing them beautiful children on the White House lawn. I love the idea of just white people being mad about it, to be quite frank. Yeah. You know, I'm good with all of that. Mm-hmm. But that's not enough to change things, because if you have a black business manager of the same imperialist, white supremacist, patriarchal, homophobic, neoliberal structure, then you ain't changed nothing. You need to change the structure. You need to move in a different direction, not just have a different driver.
Mm-hmm. Now, you got your new book, Nobody.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it talks about the nobodies in the eyes of our American government.
Yeah.
Do you think that a lot of us nobodies are going to be suffering from PTSD in the future based off everything we're seeing now, especially the unarmed killing of black men?
Well, who are the nobodies in the book? Because I don't know who the nobodies are.
People who are rendered disposable. Mm-hmm. It started when I went down to Ferguson. I was there with BET News, and I came the day after Mike Brown got killed, and I was talking to this girl, Keisha, and she was talking about how he late. I mean, Mike Brown was there for 4 hours. Mm.
His blood running down the sidewalk.
Yeah.
And then they came and covered his body up with the sheet.
Barely, right? And the sheet's barely covering his mm-hmm. body. Bugs flying around. It was a 21st century lynching, right? This is exactly what lynchings were in the 20th century, in the 19th century. You had kids standing around watching it. We got babies crying. You got people watching. And now, because of global media, Twitter, Instagram, the whole world is watching this lynching, mm-hmm. right? And she said they left him there like he ain't belong to nobody.
Right.
And when I thought about that, I said he didn't belong to nobody. People loved him. His family loved him. But in terms of the state, Normandy School District, where he went to school, broken. Worst school district, one of the worst in the country. Emerson Electric had left. St. Louis, no jobs. Pruitt-Igoe housing projects failed. So he didn't have access to anything. And I'm saying that the death of Michael Brown wasn't just about Darren Wilson killing him. It was about a set of systems that rendered him disposable long before that. But it ain't just him. It's not just Eric Garner. It's not just Sandra Bland. It's not just Walter Scott. And I cover all of them in the book. It's also, if you took all them people and they lived in a town together, that town would look like Flint, Michigan.
Right.
And so at the end of the book, I talk about Flint, Michigan, and how that whole town was rendered disposable because they're poor, they're black, mm-hmm. they're brown, they're politically disempowered. Ain't no white neighborhood gonna have lead in the water for a year.
At all.
It just wouldn't happen. And if they did, somebody would be in jail for it right now. Mm-hmm. But we're disposable. So the book breaks down not just the cases, but underneath it, broken windows policing, the broken public defender system, the broken public housing system. And I'm trying to get at all of that. And to your point about PTSD, I think we all have it.
Yeah.
I think you can't grow up where I grew up. So many of my friends are dead, man. I've seen two of my friends got killed in front of me. And it wasn't until I was older that I realized that I wasn't okay with that. You know what I mean? That there was still something there. You know what I'm saying? We joke about, you know, black people get on the floor and guns go, but we do that because
absolutely
something wrong. When white people firecrackers go off, they don't hit the deck like we do. And we joke about it, but like, because we find almost nostalgia and romance in trauma.
Are we here to firecracker? And instead of thinking it's a firecracker, the first thing we think, like, who's shooting?
Right, exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like,
one person starts running, we all start running.
Right. And we joke about it because we kind of become nostalgic about our pain. But there's a certain dysfunction to that. I would love to raise a kid who hears a firecracker and say, yo, here's a firecracker.
Yes.
And that's it. There's trauma in that. You live in Chicago where your friends die. You know your friend's going to die. You know they're going to go to jail. Or you know they're going to be addicted to something. If you in Ninth Ward, or you in the Fifth Ward, or you in wherever you are, right? That's trauma. If you go to Iraq or Afghanistan, you come back with PTSD, but we ignore the everyday trauma that comes from growing up in the hood, being poor, being dislocated, not having access to fresh fruit and vegetables. This is all what it means to be nobody. And that's what I talk about in the book. And I'm saying we got to find a way to repair that damage done, to heal that untreated trauma, But then to build a world that is not yet, we have to be able to build a world that doesn't even exist yet. That's a different imagination. And that's why the Democrats and the Republicans can't get us there. We need to go way beyond what they're offering.
How do we become somebody? Because I hate when people say things like, well, black people need to do better, and if we do better, then the system will treat us better. And I'm like, I don't necessarily agree with that, because we're the victims here.
Right.
You know?
The system isn't designed to treat you better. The system is designed to marginalize and erase you. The system is built on exploitation of black labor. The system is built on unpaid slave labor, right? And then after slavery ends, the rules just change. We prosecute slavery by other means, through prison and convict leasing and all these other things. The system is made to exploit you. We have to break the system. And asserting our somebodyness is what allows you to know that. That's what Honorable Elijah Muhammad was talking about, right? Mm-hmm. Asserting your somebodyness, the original man's Asiatic black man, the maker, the owner, creator, planet, the father of civilization, the god of the universe. Asserting that. Marcus Garvey, right, is asserting somebodyness, right? Malcolm X asserting somebodyness. You know, the I am a man signs, right? In the 60s, asserting, and I am a woman, asserting somebodyness. And once you assert that somebodyness and realize that this world isn't for you and you deserve something different, you then fight to build something different. And that's what we have to do through our education, through our music, through every part of our lives. We got to do that.
Oh, go ahead, Shelly.
Well, I was going to say, everybody treats us like, you know, nobodies. And then when something happens, their justification for that is black on black crime. It's almost like y'all kill each other, so why do you care when the police kill you? Why do they do that?
It's such a disingenuous argument. First of all, and this happens on TV all the time, right? Mm-hmm. I debate about, what about black on black? First of all, I ain't never seen none of these white people at an anti-black on black crime rally. They act as if they actually care about black people killing them. They don't. That's the first thing. Second, black on black crime is framed as a pathology, when in fact, it's simply a function of proximity. In other words,
right,
if you live near people and you get killed, it's usually somebody who lives near you that kills you. People don't usually just run from another part of town to kill you. People
right. White on white crime, Asian on Asian crime. You all live in the same community. Yeah. And so you kill the people that live in the community by you.
But isn't it magnified because we only make up 30% of the population? I mean, it's the same argument with the police. The reason police killings are so, you know, big in our community is because of the population.
Absolutely. And we have to address the fact that there is a proportionality question. We do kill each other at a higher rate than white people kill other white people. And I would argue that's an outgrowth and an artifact of white supremacy. Right. Again, part of white supremacy is to teach you that black bodies are disposable and that they're nobody. So it's much easier for you to kill me than it is for you to go kill the white boy across the street. I grew up in, like, again, we all grew up in the hood. Like, you throw trash in your own block, but when you go to a nice white neighbor, you don't throw your soda can on the floor.
Oh, it's white people.
Right. And instinctively, you don't even think about dropping it on the
ground. I do that in other areas now. Like, we go somewhere, I'll be clean as hell. We in New York, I'll be like, I'll throw the wrap out the window.
I don't like when people litter envy.
I don't like it either.
Period. I don't care where you are.
But I just thought that's what you were supposed to do. But then the other part of the black on black crime thing is that it almost suggests that because you kill each other, we have a right to kill you.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Which again is a kind of perverted, twisted logic. And then on top of that, they ignore the fact that when black people protest state violence, we're protesting the fact that the police kill. If you kill me, you're going to go to jail for it. Ain't no shortage of black people in jail for killing black people. But when white people kill us and when police kill us, we don't go to jail for it. I have full confidence that if Envy were to shoot me right now, right, that it would be a trial. And even if he didn't shoot me, he might go to jail for it.
Nah, his dad's a cop.
We don't do that. But when they kill us, we don't have access to a fair trial. Mm-hmm. They kill us with impunity. They kill us on tape, and they still don't go to jail for it. That's the issue. And so for me, it's the black on black crime issue is like, I don't, and also the last thing about that is we don't march against black on black crime because that's not the way to fix black on black crime. The way to fix black on black crime is violence interruption, which we do in Chicago. It's about investing early childhood education, early head start, food, clothing, and shelter on all levels, access to education, food security. These are the things that stop us from killing each other. When people got jobs, they don't kill each other nearly as much.
They're busy.
But when we got jobs, police still kill us. Dude got killed on his way to work by the police officer in Minnesota. Mm-hmm. So, it's apples and oranges, and that's why we engage them differently.
Now, with your rhetoric that you speak and you talk about, and especially being proud, being pro-black and African-American, does that make you nervous with any of your jobs, working at VH1 and doing your CNN and Huffington Post?
It used to until I got fired. I got fired from Fox News.
Yeah, I was going to say, what about at Fox? Because I'm sure
you... Oh, Fox is crazy. So Fox fired me. So once Fox fired me, I was like, I approach every job like, every day I go on the air, I could be fired.
Right.
And so...
So you might as well say what you want.
Why did they even hire you at Fox? That's crazy to me.
Because Fox is to news what pro wrestling is to sports. Mm-hmm. Right? It's like news, but it's not exactly news. It's about the show.
Right.
And so when you go on Fox News, they're performing something, right? It's like a Globetrotter game for mm-hmm. Republicans. The Republicans are the Globetrotters and everybody else is the generals. And they just want to watch you them beat up on you. Mm-hmm. So they bring me in to lose. I'm a young black guy. I started when I was 26. Mm-hmm. I just got my PhD, in fact. And they will always call me doctor in this condescending way. So that was like, I'm Bill O'Reilly and I'm schooling Dr. Hill. You know, it was that kind of a thing, right? But I wasn't losing. You know what I mean? If I'm on the generals, I'm one day you just say, you know what, I'm tired of losing. You just start crossing, you know what I mean? Like, right. And that's what I did, and I started to win too much. And that was the real issue, I think. They ultimately fired me because they said I had radical ties, right? Which meant that because I supported Mumia Abu-Jamal, who is not guilty and who remains incarcerated, because I supported Asada.
Walking around the office with an Elijah Muhammad t-shirt.
Yeah, shit like that, right? Yeah. I would do that just to troll him, you know what I mean? Yeah, just yeah. That one. No, but like, but ultimately I was winning debates and they didn't like that. Roger Ailes particularly didn't like that. And then
yeah, like he's the greatest guy to talk about morals.
Exactly. Come to find out. Oh, I wish yeah. I knew that. But when I saw that, I was like, man, look at God. You know what I mean? Yeah. But the other part about Fox, man, is that they're so deeply invested in the Republican agenda. It's not a news outlet. The day Obama won, it looked like a funeral in there. I was working there in 08, and I walked in there about 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Cause you usually know who gonna win the election, honestly, before the night.
He was in there like woohoo.
I walked in the joint. Right. I walked up in there and I was like, what's wrong? Everybody, they said, go up to the fifth floor, Mark. And I'm never allowed on the fifth floor. That's like where only like the white people go. And I usually stay on the fourth. And I went up there, and Ailes was in there, all the producers in there, and it was like this funeral. And it's the day Obama is about to be elected. I'm thinking somebody got killed. Cause you know, we was all thinking like he might get shot.
Absolutely.
Right. So I'm like, yo, what happened? They're like, we got bad news. I'm like, what happened? They were like, he's gonna win. And I was like, what? And they were like,
he was like, yeah.
I was right. Me and the janitors in the corner like this. And I'm like, yeah. And the rest of them is like really sad. And they're like, yo, but don't worry. They're saying this to each other. They're giving each other pep. Don't worry. The next 4 years, we are going to make his life hell. And we're going to make a lot of money. That's literally what they said.
Damn.
And for the next 4 years, that's what they did.
Wow.
You know, and so, and I saw Sean Hannity at the convention. He was like, yo, I can't believe this guy won the nomination. He said, I did everything I could to stop it. You know, he's like.
Talking about Trump or?
Talking about Obama back in over. He's like, okay. He was like, you know, I threw Jeremiah Wright at him. I threw someone. I mean, he was saying it like frustrated, like, yo, really? Like, I can't believe, like, that's their goal. And so working there was a trip. But then once they fired me, mm-hmm. I feel liberated. And I'm like, you know, I feel free to say what I want. I go on TV and I say what I believe. And I'm fully comfortable that one day it's going to end. But as a truth teller, that's the job. You know what I mean? And so I don't mind battling about racism with a Harry Houck or talking about the N-word with Trinidad James. I don't mind doing that because I know it's going to end anyway. And if it's going to end, I want it to end on my... These jobs all end. We all going to lose.
I've been fired 4 times. Trust me. I came to that conclusion a long
time
ago.
Right. It's going to end. No matter how good you do, 99% of the time it's going to end anyway. So you might as well go hard and end it on your terms.
How do you feel about Stacey Dash?
I think the Republican line is shorter for black people. Right. Mm-hmm. So if Stacey Dash were a liberal, she wouldn't be on TV.
Right.
Right. But as a conservative, the line is short. All you got to do is be able to say something ignorant about black people, say something disrespectful about black people, and you're on.
Give her a show.
Yeah. And give her a show. Or give her a book. Give her this. Give her that. And so I watch it happen time after time. There are some black Republicans who really believe what they say. Mm-hmm. And I respect them. I disagree with them, but I respect them. Right. Because there's a conservative strain in all of us. Right. But then, or in our community anyway. But people like Stacey Dash, I feel like they're just saying it to get on. Right. You know, these people like Kevin Jackson, you know, all these like people who are
Larry
like,
Elder.
Larry Elder. I mean, Larry Elder's a clown. You know what I mean?
Super clown.
He's a clown. You know what I mean? He'll say anything to get on TV. You know what I mean? And that frustrates me that the world is like that. It's just a new form of skinning and grinning.
I think Stacey just want a man, to be honest. I think Stacey want
Stacey got no problem getting
I think
a man.
She want a rich white man, so she just playing the role to get her one of them rich Republican white
Stacey
men.
Stacey Dash could put on red, black, and green Black Panther outfit and get a dude.
Like, that's true.
She do not need to lie to get a dude. Like, Republican, Democrat don't matter. I think people get addicted to the spotlight and they want the money and they go in.
Now you saw this Miss Teen USA controversy where the woman who won Miss Teen USA had some old tweets where she was using the N-word.
I heard about it. Yeah.
And all of that controversy, but they are backing her and saying, okay, it should be fine to let her go ahead and keep that crown. Do you think something like that should matter?
I mean, it's an interesting question because I don't necessarily like beauty pageants in general because how they deal with, you know, exploitation of bodies and such. But if a black person has it in their history, I'm like, I use the N-word, so mm-hmm. I use it promiscuously, so I have no problem right. with black people using it. I think white people should not use it, but if you use it at 10 or 11 years old, particularly how this culture works, I think it's something we need to work.
But it
through.
Wasn't with the A at the end; it was with the ER at the
See,
end.
See, that's what I need context, right? Was it like, you know?
Hold on, let me pull it up.
If you got content, because in any case, I do think people are bigger than their mistakes, particularly if you do it at 10 or 11 years old. I've seen Justin Bieber do that. You know what I mean? And it's like, I don't think it's cool. I think you should be challenged and censured for it. But I'm not sure if you do it at 10 years old that you should lose your career or lose a crown if you really work through it.
That's Isn't it hard to make those teachable moments, though? Because if you're talking to one of these little kids, 9 times out of 10, they're mimicking their favorite rapper. And they do not understand the historical context of the word at all. So when you come to them, you be like, that's wrong. You shouldn't say it because of this, this, and that. And then they look at you and be like, well, it's all through the music.
Well, these posts were from 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And she was writing.
Like, so she was like 14, 13,
yeah, she 14. Was writing to her friends. She said, I know I'm a comedian, N-word. Don't threaten me. I will wrap your house, N-word. And I don't have your number, N-word.
So see, that's regular context.
Yeah, I think she's using it, trying to talk like a black person. It's not okay. I think it's actually, right. I think white people should never use the word. But I do think that that's a different thing than like, get off my lawn.
Yeah, you know
what I mean?
Now, right. What Charlamagne just said, you actually teach classes, which is pertaining to Jay-Z and Nas' lyrics, right?
Yeah, I actually teach a Jay-Z Nas class. And that's one of the things we wrestle with is how language gets used and how we think about it and who has access to this language. I don't want us to infantilize white people, though, because we always say white people get confused. They hear us use it, they don't know what to do. Or they hear rappers do it, they don't know what to do. White people have managed to run the entire world for the last 400 years. They can comprehend the idea that black people can say it.
The kids are different, Mark.
Because kids...
The kids are different, man.
I think they pick up on it and want to do it, but I think as soon as you tell them you can't, I don't want to let them off the hook where they say, well, I'm confused because Raheem does it, why can't I do it? I'm saying once we tell them, I agree with you at the onset, but once we tell them, they can't keep using the I'm confused excuse, which is what I keep hearing, right? Like, well, I keep listening to rap music and black people keep saying this, so I just feel like I can still say it. White people want to control and run the world, and they get mad when it's something they can't do.
Yeah.
And the fact that I can say it and they can't pisses them off to no end. Mm-hmm. And it's like, if I could just have that word, I'd have access to everything. That's what it feels
but
like.
But you know, in the music though, like, you know, when you have artists using it in their hook and you see them rapping it, you know, it's kind of hard to be like, don't say that, because they're really just enjoying the music that we put out.
And I've seen rappers, and I do it myself sometimes, walk up to white people and like, what's up, my like, you know what I mean?
I do it too.
Yeah, I do it to them. They ain't got to say it back. Let me ask you a question. Let me ask you a question, right?
Don't say it back.
Lil' Kim spits a verse about...
I used to be scared of it.
When you in the club, you be like, I used to be scared of it. Now I throw lips on it. That's what you say when you
Bishop Betty Long definitely says that.
Nah, I don't say that.
Exactly. You find a way.
I've seen Envy say that.
No, I don't. Shut up, Mariah.
And I've seen Charlamagne do the Pretty Girl Rock and sing Pretty Girl.
No, but I understand exactly what Mark's saying. I do not sing the Lil' Kim part.
That's what I'm saying. Don't do that. You mentally shut down.
Absolutely.
When that part, come on, right? And I'm not trying to be homophobic, because it's not wrong. People who want to do that get busy. You know what I mean? But I'm saying, you mentally decide that part ain't for you.
Right.
Absolutely.
You don't get seduced by the beat. You don't get caught into the moment where you start rapping Nicki Minaj.
I never looked at it like that.
You'd be like, nope, that line ain't for me.
Exactly.
So white people, that line ain't for you.
Now, you said every 28 hours an unarmed black man is killed by police.
Yeah. I was quoting the Malcolm X grassroots report, which says that every 28 hours a black person is killed by law enforcement or a vigilante. Yes.
Oh, okay. So that still applies to...
Yes. The number is somewhat disputed because of how we account for it, but... Considering the fact that most of them don't get reported and that there's no federal tracking system, I would argue the number's about the same,
And that's what I was going to ask. I was like, if that happens, why come it's not a hashtag every day?
Because most people get killed by police, it doesn't make a hashtag. First of all, you need to get killed by police and become a hashtag, you got to like have a video. You got to have a video.
HD.
Right. Video. HD, right.
Video. Repeated on some news network.
Exactly, exactly. Like, it's incredibly difficult. And that's the thing. We only get a cause for us when we have indisputable proof.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Our witness is not enough. Part of being nobody in America is that just us saying it happened doesn't matter.
Even with video proof, it kind of seems like it doesn't really matter so much.
They were Rodney King ass on tape for 15 minutes. And they told a jury, they convinced a jury that if we hadn't done that, he would have gotten up and ran through the whole town and killed everybody. I mean, that's basically what they say. Mm-hmm. We had to do it. Don't believe your lying eyes. Believe what we tell you. That is the nature of white supremacy. And people want to believe it. Jurors want to believe it. They want to believe it. They want to believe that Trayvon deserved to die. They want to believe that Eric Garner deserved to die.
So see, not only it scares me because like you get anxiety, you get frustration, you just get straight out fear.
Right.
Because you're like, how do we combat the injustice?
Yeah. You organize. A lot of times we react. Action is important, but organizing is more important.
Mm-hmm.
We need organized action. For example, we need cop watch programs.
Mm-hmm. Right.
There's no reason in Brooklyn, where I live, why we shouldn't have cop watches on every, not at every part. You don't need it in Park Slope. I don't live in Park Slope, but not in Park Slope. But you need it in East New York, right? All the people that complain about police, in addition to marching, which we do, and I think that's important, and voting, which I think is important, we need to be on corners. we need to be policing the police.
Like the Black Panthers did.
Like the Black Panthers
And people get so crazy, like, oh, why would you say that's a militant group? Like, all they did was police the police.
They police the
police. Who did the Black Panthers ever hurt? I mean, of course they went rogue.
And there were incidents, but they were always in response.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? If you police the police, that doesn't happen. We need to be fighting for citizen review boards, civilian review boards.
Oh, I use that.
Yeah.
I use that citizen complaint review board. Right. I've actually had to use that before on a police officer because people don't know sometimes certain things are available, mm-hmm. but when you file that complaint online, you do have to show up and go to mediation.
Sometimes
the cop has to be held. And some people, I did all of that though.
Right.
But
you had
a
problem with the same officer. She showed up and I didn't. I ain't had time.
I was there.
You ain't want to snitch on the police because you connected to the police.
Oh, no, I definitely. I talked about it on the air like crazy, but I just said, all right. I ain't had time. You know, I ain't had time.
But you gotta have time.
You gotta have time.
Yeah, you have to if it matters to you because to me, that's something that's going to be helpful for the next person.
Yep. Most people work. They can't take
for that
off
to
work.
Go, for that to go on their record. Right. But right. I also feel like for police officers, they should have some type of community service that is part of their job also where they have to actually go in the community and do things while they're on their on time, you know, for their police duties, that should be part of it.
Yeah.
That way you interact with people outside of you pulling them over arresting them for something.
I want police out of the community. I feel you. And I think, so there's two models.
What do you mean, Mark?
I want to live in a world where we don't need police in our community.
Well, I would love for that, but some of these Negroes don't know how to act.
They need Mark. Police. See,
some of us need police.
Some of them need a little police.
But we can community police. So here's what I'm saying. I think there's the reformist strategy and there's a radical strategy. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying that right now, I'm agreeing with you. We need to police, and the people who police those police need to be independent, right? Because mm-hmm. the problem is, I sued the Philadelphia police, mm-hmm. right? And I filed a report, and the police read the report. And then they give the report to the cop who I'm complaining against.
Right.
They let him read what I said, and then they let him respond to it.
What'd you sue for?
It was about 5 years ago. I sued Officer Richard DeCotesworth. And he, because he pulled me over, he said I was in the wrong neighborhood with the wrong car.
Really?
And threw me against the car, did an illegal search, all this stuff. And when I asked him why he pulled me over, he said illegal discharge of a passenger.
What?
What?
I dropped my homie off at the corner. I mean, I don't know what.
I've never heard of that
in my life.
I think he made it up. So I filed a report, and
They don't anticipate that.
They don't anticipate that because they didn't know who I was.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Once he put out my checkbook, and my checkbook had doctor on it, right? And first he thought I stole the checkbook, then he matched it against my license.
Wow.
Then he was like, oh, you know what? I'm going to let you go. He was like, but just don't stay out of this neighborhood. I'm where I grew up.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
the
yeah.
thing. He just didn't think I belonged there, right? So anyway, so I filed a report. The police rejected it. I sued anyway. Then, and when it came out, it was like hip-hop professor sues decorated cop, right?
Because
the cop had been shot in the face, and Obama had him at his first State of the Union. He was his hero cop. Anyway. So 2 years later, he's off the force. Turned out not only had he done that to me, he had shot someone in the back and the forensic had lied about it.
Mm.
He had done like three other things. And then he eventually got caught for prostitution, drugs, all these crimes. He had the highest bail in Pennsylvania history. That's but crazy. When I said it, they didn't believe it. You know what I mean? It wasn't until he hit a cop that he mm-hmm. got kicked off the force. But building the case mattered.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because if I hadn't done that, then there wouldn't have been somebody else who could do that.
That's right. Why it is important to make sure you document when something happens to you.
Right.
Even though it might be a hassle.
We got to do it, but we have to police the police. So we have to do that. We need to have a kind of investment in our community so that police have a different relationship to our community. Mm-hmm. I agree with that.
Right.
But I'm saying long term, I want to figure out ways for us to police our own communities, for us to govern ourselves, for us to have dispute resolution, community-based things. I get it. If somebody's in the block raping people or shooting up the block, I'm not saying we should just handle it ourselves. But I'm saying those are the extremes, and that's different than having a kind of occupied territory vibe, which is what you see in parts of urban areas right now where police are everywhere all the time. Mm-hmm. Stop and frisk is a big part of that. We can fix that by policing our own stuff and by creating different relationships to the community.
It's kind of like being like how we live in Brooklyn, right? You know how they have like the Orthodox Jewish community there?
Yep.
And they police themselves.
Yeah, ain't no police running around.
Yeah, they kind of have their own laws and things that they handle within their own community.
I love your idea, but Negroes are a little bit more unruly. And I think that we need people from our community to go into that system, that blue wall, and disrupt it. We need more of us becoming police officers, but not, you know, abiding by that whole blue wall of silence, being a part of that system. Like, we need a tea party in the police
force. But you know what, talking to a lot of police officers, you know, a lot of police officers say that if they do go against that blue, it's problems for them. Then everything that they work
next thing you know, they're demoted, they're on desk duty.
They don't get promoted. They makes their life
nobody
miserable.
Talks to them.
So nobody talks to them. They wind up getting fired. And that 4 or 5 years they spent on the force is for nothing.
That's why you got
to
be courageous, though. Again, mm-hmm. there's always something at stake when you tell the truth.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And essentially, saying I can't do the right thing because it'll cost me. It's always going to cost you.
Mm-hmm.
If you're committed to us and you love us, then you got to make the sacrifice for us.
Right.
Do you still believe black people are incapable of practicing racism?
How are you defining racism?
I don't know. I mean, I'm trying to define what I feel at times now.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, I mean, of course, we're dealing with everything that we see on television, but I'm watching Orange is the New Black the other night, right?
Oh,
season 4.
It's a good season.
I didn't see it. I didn't finish it till Sunday.
Okay.
And I'm watching the last episode. I turn to my wife and I go, see, this is why I hate white people sometimes. You know what I'm saying? And I don't know if that's racism or
no,
not.
No, it's not racist.
Okay. All right.
That's not all racist.
Right. This, okay.
First of all, you don't literally hate white people.
No, right? I just hate what they do to us.
Right. And second,
it's because you're oppressed and you feel.
Yeah, and it's a response to oppression.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Got you.
So if you define racism as prejudice or bias, sure. I mean, anybody can be prejudiced or biased, right? Mm-hmm. But as an academic, I define racism as a systemic issue. It's prejudice plus power. It's the ability to not just have prejudice or discriminatory ideals, but it's the ability to institute those things in society. So I might think white people are ugly, and white people might think a white person might think I'm ugly, right? That for hypothetical.
Right.
The difference is white people thinking I'm ugly means that they cover all the magazines, mm-hmm. all the anchors look white.
Look white.
You know what I mean? The Barbie dolls look white.
The ugly people get looks.
Right. Right. Exactly. The whole world changes based on white people's ideals and norms.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you go buy a flesh color Band-Aid, it's peach, right? So you grew up thinking you got the wrong color flesh, right? There are all these ways that they normalize their ideals against the backdrop of ours. To me, that's what racism is about. It's about defining realities for others and making them think that it's theirs.
There you have it.
Well, we appreciate you joining us today, man.
Yeah, it's my pleasure.
Yeah, I can sit and talk to Mark all day.
I know, we could.
Like, literally.
We could talk about your light skin, dark skin differences, but we'll do that another
time. That's all in fun, though. That's it. Like,
we talk about some people do act light skin, though.
You're looking at them.
Some people act dark. You see, trying to
I don't know. That's racist. That's racist.
See, now, how come that? That's okay.
But some people just be acting light skin sometimes.
That's an age thing, too, because these millennials, they look at us and they be like, oh, I can't believe y'all doing colorism.
Right.
It's like, yo, we grew up joking like that, bro. Like,
we don't mean it, right?
Wow.
I love it.
I mean, we mean it, but we don't mean it.
Mean it.
Right. You know what I mean?
It was hurtful for some people, though, growing up, too.
Like, I get hurt when you call me waffle color Negro. Like, that
hurts me. Like, we're old enough to know that if we see Drake, Drake is the epitome of light skin.
He acts, and I love Drake, but he acts light.
That's what I'm saying.
He makes light skin music.
There's nothing wrong with that. Well, there you have it.
Nobody, hold that up one time,
book is called Nobody. Casualties of America's War on the Vulnerable. Ferguson to Flint and Beyond. It's in bookstores everywhere. It's also on Amazon. Get it today. Support black books. And watch VH1 Live.
Right? All right. There we have it. It's
10 p.m. Sunday.
Marc Lamont Hill is the Breakfast Club. Good morning.
If superior hair extensions, clip-ins, and tape-ins are an absolute must, you have to get the number one rated hair extensions in the world. Her Imports is 100% certified real virgin human hair and trusted by celebrity stylists worldwide. Celebrities swear by our products, and now you can too. We now offer financing for our products at herimports.com for a limited time, or go into one of our convenient locations in your city. We offer 100% Indian temple bundles that will have you looking flawless for years. Visit us online right now at herimports.com.
The Breakfast Club, every weekday morning. Tune in.